بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد Dear respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to a new episode from this series where we are discussing the story of the second generation, the second best, the tabi'een. May Allah Jalla wa Ala be pleased with them all. We spent a few episodes discussing the story of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and I feel that 4, 5, 6, 7 episodes will not be enough to discuss the story of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. However, we need to move to discuss some other personalities. During the discussion of the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, we mentioned a single personality called Rajaa ibn Hayawah. He was the main minister, not the prime minister, the first minister during the time of Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik and during the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz as well. Who is Rajaa ibn Hayawah, or who was Rajaa ibn Hayawah? Rajaa ibn Hayawah is a person who was born at the end of the life of Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And he was from Palestine, originally from Palestine, from a tribe that from Kinda, which is a Palestinian tribe. And he was also from Palestine. So his tribe was Kinda. He's known as Rajaa ibn Hayawah al-Kindi. And they said that his father was one of the companions, or lahu suhba, or he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And he was, as we said, that he lived some of his life in Palestine, and then he moved to other parts of Asham. He studied with number of Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. That's why he was considered among the tabi'een. He studied with Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the very famous jurist, Sahabi jurist, whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam considered him as the best jurist. And he said, وَأَفْقَهُكُمْ Mu'adh, and he is the most knowledgeable person in fiqh in terms of jurisprudence. He also studied with Abu Umama radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and he also studied with some other sahabi radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. He taught number of tabi'in and the number of third generation. And they used to say that Rajaa ibn Hayawah is the best person in Asham. In fact, Aunu ibn Abdullah used to say that the best person in Medina was Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, and the best person in Iraq is Abu al-Hasan al-Basri, and the best person in Asham is Rajaa ibn Hayawah. Rajaa ibn Hayawah, I'm discussing his personality briefly because there is not much to be said about him, or the books of history did not record much about his life. But they said that he started to acquire knowledge from a very young age, and he was appointed as a minister for Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik as well as Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He was a very wise person. We mentioned his story when he was appointed, when he was in charge of the administration during the time of Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, and when Abdul Malik was about to die, and he wrote the book to assign a khalifa, a successor for him, and he wrote that the khalifa next to him, or the khalifa after him, will be Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And we saw how Rajaa ibn al-Hayawah dealt with this situation, where he took the book and he hid that Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik passed away, and he asked the royal family members to give bay'ah to the person who is in this book. So they gave bay'ah to the person who was appointed by the ex-Khalifa Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, and they didn't know that Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik at that time died, and this was a wise maneuver from Rajaa ibn Hayawah. He was a very righteous person, and they said that he helped Umar ibn Abdul Aziz a lot in and supported him in managing the affairs of the Ummah at that time and giving him advices. He said one time that he was alone and he heard someone is telling him, Ya Rajaa, you became in this position in the government. You are the first minister in the government. So you have to fear Allah Jalla wa'ala. And you should know that whenever you support a weak person and you present his case before the Khalifa, Allah Jalla wa'ala will present your case at the day of resurrection. Allah Jalla wa'ala will, which means Allah Jalla wa'ala will support you at the day of resurrection as you supported this. This reminds us of the very famous hadith that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever is in service of his Muslim brother, Allah Jalla wa'ala will be in his service. That's why Rajaa ibn Hayawah was, he never abused his position as the first minister, and he was advising the caliphs, Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, as well as Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and he never abused his position to acquire wealth or to acquire other things. They said that Rajaa ibn Hayawah, he used to have some profound statements and profound advices. One time he said to one of his friends, you have to be careful when you befriend people. Don't look up for a perfect friend, otherwise you will not find so many friends. And then he said, if a person criticizes his friends for any mistake or admonishes them for any mistake, then he will have so many enemies. Then he will have so many enemies. This reminds us of the famous poetry in Arabic, إِذَا كُنْتَ فِي كُلِّ الْأُمُورِ مُعَاتِبًا لَمْ يَبْقَ الَّذِي لَا تُعَاتِبُ. If you are criticizing your friends in every matter or admonishing them in every matter, you will not have many friends. Rajaa ibn Hayawah, we knew some of his stories with Umar ibn Abdul Aziz رضي الله تعالى عنه, where he was advising Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. They said that when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz passed away, Hisham ibn Abdul Malik, who came after Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he sacked Rajaa ibn Hayawah from being the first minister. They said that Hisham ibn Abdul Malik saw in the dream that his brothers are admonishing him because of what he did for Rajaa ibn Hayawah, so he restored his position. Rajaa ibn Hayawah one time was giving a sermon or giving a dars in the masjid, and they told him, he was saying that it is rarely that anyone thanks the ni'am of Allah Jalla wa'ala, the bounties of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So a person, it is a quite interesting story, a person told him, don't you think that Amir al-Mu'mineen will be thankful to Allah Jalla wa'ala? So Rajaa ibn Hayawah said, even Amir al-Mu'mineen, he will not be thankful to Allah Jalla wa'ala for all bounties. He was not talking about certain bounties, he was talking about all bounties. So this person, who was known as Sahib al-Kisa, he used to have special clothes, or he used to cover his head with certain clothes or certain garment, and they known him as Sahib al-Kisa. So this person, he went and he reported this to the Khalifa. Then a policeman came from the Khalifa and he said, Rajaa ibn Hayawah, have you said that Amir al-Mu'mineen will not be thankful to Allah Jalla wa'ala? Then Rajaa ibn Hayawah said, no, I haven't said this. Then he said, Allah means, can you swear by this? He said, Allah. So he swore an oath, despite the fact that he mentioned something like this. But because he knew that if he were to be caught in that position, he might be killed. So as a result of this, they took this person, the reporter or the agent who reported this incident, they took him and flogged him. Rajaa ibn Hayawah came to him and this person said to Rajaa ibn Hayawah, and you are Rajaa ibn Hayawah, means you are the scholar, the righteous person, and you lie. He said, it is better for me to lie rather than it will be in your neck the blood of a Muslim person. It will be in your neck, because if you, a Muslim person, or the blood of a Muslim person will be shed, so you will bear the responsibility at the day of resurrection. So I preferred that I lie, this happens to you, rather than a person such as myself will be killed because of you. This shows that sometimes the person might lie if he knows that the consequences are grave. However, we have to be careful. It is not just your estimation that you the consequences might be grave when you lie, but we have to be careful. You have to be careful, and you cannot just lie at any point of time, or if there is just any kind of difficulty or any kind of necessity. It has to be a genuine case, and every person should fear Allah Jalla wa'ala as much as he can. They told him once, Raja, the Khalifa now left you. The Khalifa now left you, and he is not interested of having you as the main minister. He said, if they left me, I don't care. Let me care about myself, and I spend my time in ibadah and coming closer to Allah Jalla wa Ala and worshipping Allah Jalla wa Ala. Then he just remained alone doing ibadah, and he left the Khulafa. They said that he died in year 112. We have to stop for a break, and inshallah after the break we will take another story. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Welcome to Hoda TV's newest breakthrough into the world of Islamic media and academics, Hoda Academy. With courses in Aqidah, Tafsir, Fiqh, Hadith, and Arabic, and your most favorite Hoda TV scholars, Hoda Academy is your chance to enrich your mind and heart. Prices are affordable. The knowledge is authentic. The scholars are real. And the location is your home. Since Hoda TV's inception and the dream of Hoda Academy has been on our minds, after years of hard work, the dream is now here. Just like Hoda TV, Hoda Academy is a non-profit project, and your tuition fees go straight back into developing more courses. Knowing the basics of Islam is an obligation, but in-depth knowledge of our deen is reserved for those Allah guides to take the extra step. Your chance to become a student of Islamic knowledge is here, literally at your fingertips. Take a leap and join us today. Hoda Academy, your gateway to authentic Islamic knowledge.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brothers and sisters. Before the break, we were talking about the story of Rajaa ibn Hayawah, the first minister. I wanted to speak about him because I want to show to our brothers and sisters that we have different personalities of Islam. We took the story of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He was the Khalifa, a political leader. We took the story of Al-Hasan al-Basri. He was a very zahid person. He gave up the dunya. We took the story of Ali ibn al-Husayn, and he was a rounded personality, one of the family members of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Each personality gives us insight in certain areas of al-Islam. And we need to study number of personalities in order to have a better idea of Islamic, of many other Islamic practices. A Muslim can be a minister. And if he was appointed as the main minister or the first minister, then he should make use of that position to serve Islam and Muslims. The common thing among all these personalities is to what? To support Islam and Muslims. In fact, if you would like to say the main concern of all these personalities, the common ground between all of them, the main aim of all of them is what? Is to save themselves from the punishment of Allah Jalla wa Ala and to be admitted to Jannah. قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Protect yourselves and your families from the punishment of Allah Jalla wa Ala. That should be our main concern. And this aim, which is what? To be saved from hellfire, has to be manifested wherever we are located. If we are businessmen, if we are leaders, if we are commanders, if we are political leaders, name it, you name it, we have to strive to please our Lord in order to what? In order to be granted Jannah. Even we mentioned some of the stories of some of women, great women in Islam, such as Mu'adha al-Adawiyya, the wife of Sila, such as Umrah bint Abdul Rahman, such as Talha bint, such as Aisha bint Talha ibn Ubaidillah, great women, and they had the same aim. The aim was to get into Jannah, to save themselves from the punishment of hell. That's why they were taking any opportunity to achieve this goal. Today or now, I will be speaking about another personality. That personality was not a scholar. That personality was another extraordinary personality. He was one of the commanders of Muslims. This personality is Uqbah ibn Naafi' al-Fihri. Uqbah ibn Naafi' al-Fihri, he was one of the Muslim commanders in northern of Africa. Uqbah ibn Naafi' al-Fihri al-Qurashi, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah jalla wa ala be pleased with him. They said that he was born just 1 year before the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, but he did not have the opportunity to migrate to Medina to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Some other historians say that he was born after that, but it is likely that he was born 1 year before the hijrah, because he attended the fath of Egypt, the conquer of Egypt, with Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. He attended the fath of Egypt with Amr ibn al-As. And we know that Amr ibn al-As conquered Egypt and opened Egypt for Islam and Muslim on year 20th of Hijrah. So it is likely that he attended the fath of Egypt, the conquer of Egypt, when he was around that age, 20-something. Uqbah ibn Naafi' al-Fihri, he was participating in the fath of Egypt, the conquer of Egypt, along with Amr ibn al-As. And you know that Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, appointed Amr ibn al-As to open Egypt, to conquer Egypt and the lands next to Egypt. So Amr ibn al-As, he conquered Egypt on that year, and it is recorded in history. And one of the main people who supported him is that young person, Uqbah ibn Naafi' radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Then Amr ibn al-As wanted to expand and to open more lands for Islam and Muslims. So he sent Uqbah ibn Naafi' to Zuwayla, one area next to Egypt, in the southern part of Egypt. So Uqbah ibn Naafi' managed to conquer that land and managed to include it into the land of Muslims. And then Amr ibn al-As appointed him as the commander and the leader of that land. So Uqba ibn, and then Amr ibn al-As wrote to Umar ibn al-Khattab that I appointed Uqba ibn Nafi' as the commander of that land. You know that Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was used to have long sight. Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was one of the main personalities of Islam. He was a very clever person and he knew people. So he discovered that this young person, Uqba ibn Nafi' radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, will be among the great leaders of al-Islam. That's why he appointed him as a commander to open or to protect the borders of the Muslim state in Egypt at that time. And Uqba ibn Nafi' was successful in doing that. Then when Amr ibn al-As was removed from being the governor of Egypt and Ibn Abi Sarh was appointed as the governor of Egypt, he allowed Uqba ibn Nafi' to continue in expanding the Islamic state and conquering lands there in order to open it for Islam and Muslims. And Uqba ibn Nafi' did this and he started to open the lands in what is known now as Libya or the land of Burqa, and then he went all the way to reach to Tunisia, what is known now as Tunisia. Brothers and sisters, imagine at that time there were no transportation and it is a desert. You know, Libya is mainly a desert. So it would be very difficult for the Muslim army to travel. However, they managed to travel, to conquer and open that land for Islam and Muslims in a very short period of time because of this extraordinary leader, Uqba ibn Nafi' radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And then Uqba ibn Nafi' radiyallahu ta'ala anhu went beyond Tunisia and he almost opened all Tunisia for Islam and Muslims. And they said at that time, the people of Tunisia, or what is known as Tunisia, Libya, and the areas around them started to accept Islam. Then Uqba ibn Nafi' even moved from Tunisia all the way to what is known now as Algeria. And he started to open more lands for Islam and Muslims. At one point, they said that when Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, we knew that he became the Khalifa and he died on year 60. He continued for Khilafah for almost 20 years in Al-Sham. At one point, Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu removed Uqba ibn Nafi' from being the main commander there and appointed another person called Abu al-Muhajir. His name was Abu al-Muhajir. Abu al-Muhajir unfortunately dealt badly with Uqba ibn Nafi' and in fact they said that he imprisoned him. After some time, Abu al-Muhajir left Uqba ibn Nafi'. Uqba ibn Nafi' went all the way to the center of the Islamic State in Al-Sham. They said that when he reached Al-Sham, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu passed away. So the next Khalifa was Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Uqba ibn Nafi' had a discussion with Yazid ibn Muawiyah about the Islamic state the Muslim land there. And then he sort of rebuked him for what has happened by Abu al-Muhajir, the other commander. And Yazid ibn Muawiyah said that or appointed him as the commander of that area again. So Uqba ibn Nafi' went again to that area and he became the commander of that area. And there was a tension between him and that personality, the other, or the ex-amir, whose name was Abu al-Muhajir. The point is, Uqba ibn Nafi' radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he doesn't want to stay without jihad. He wanted to continue for jihad. And that's why he went despite of what has happened to him. We are coming to the end of this episode. Inshallah, we will continue the discussion after. We will, inshallah, continue the discussion of this, of the story of this personality, inshallah, in the following episode. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.